Good afternoon and welcome. My name is Teresa Ladrigan-Wilpley, and I serve as the Director of Institutes in Spirituality in the Ignatian Center for Jesuit Education here at Santa Clara. The work of the Ignatian Center is to advance Santa Clara's distinctively Jesuit Catholic tradition of education by promoting the integration of faith, justice, and the intellectual life on campus, here today, and in the larger community. One of the ways that we seek to actualize this integrating vision and mission is through our year-long Bannon Institutes. The Bannon Institute was founded in 1982 by three generations of the Bannon family to honor their Uncle Lou, Louis I. Bannon of the Society of Jesus, a longtime teacher and counselor at the university. This afternoon's event is our inaugural Father Lou Bannon lecture, which will become an annual Bannon Institute offering, seeking to further the originating purpose of the Institute, articulated 32 years ago, and I quote, to improve and enhance the Ignatian spirit of the whole university community, faculty, students, staff, alumni, and friends. As you know, this year's Bannon Institute has been centered around the quite provocative question, what good is God? We began in the fall by unpacking the tensive but mutually constitutive frames of secular and religious culture. Next, we moved in the winter to engage the vexing but expansive intersections among contemporary scientific and religious and technological paradigms. Now, as we round the corner of our academic year, we turn the spotlight on ourselves, asking, what good is God in the life of the university? No doubt this question has been engaged in diverse and often conflicting ways on our campus this year, arguably more than ever before. But as it turns out, we are not alone. Early universities within the United States were largely established to advance the ideals of liberal education within a religious, moral framework. And yet, in the last century, the academy has become widely ambivalent about the place of God in the broader discourse of university. As our speaker today suggests, good people of many persuasions wonder how a thinking person can still believe in God. Still others wonder whether a university, as an academic institution, is a place where God should be openly discussed at all. Our inaugural Louis I. Bannon lecturer, Father Michael C. McCarthy of the Society of Jesus, will argue that attention to the real fragility of faith may open spaces for different kinds of discussions entirely. Father McCarthy began his undergraduate career at Stanford University, but then entered the Jesuits and received a BA from Santa Clara University in 1987. He also earned an MA from Oxford University, a Master's in Divinity from the Jesuit School of Theology, now Santa Clara University, and in 2003 earned his Ph.D. in Theology from the University of Notre Dame. Father McCarthy holds the Edmund Campion S.J. Professor Endowed Chair, and is an associate professor with a joint appointment in the Religious Studies and Classics departments, as well as the director of the Catholic Studies program. Since 2011, he has also ably served as the executive director of the Ignatian Center for Jesuit Education and my boss. More significant, however, than all these noteworthy degrees, accolades, and academic positions is the impact Father McCarthy has had on the living questions and vocations of the students, faculty, and staff at Santa Clara and beyond. For example, one of his former students, who graduated in 2008, shared with me only yesterday, Mick McCarthy has taught me to grapple fiercely with mystery without attempting to subdue or reduce this world's complexity. And perhaps most importantly, he has let me know that I am not alone in these religious wrestlings, but in the good company of many inquiring people of faith, past and present. Let us now enjoy the good company of Father Mick McCarthy as he shares his lecture entitled, The Fragility of Faith, How Can a Thinking Person Still Believe in God? Please join me in welcoming Father McCarthy.
Usually at this point, the lecturer thanks the Ignatian Center for their hospitality and for inviting them. And while I do and will thank the Ignatian Center, my reasons for doing so go far, far, far deeper than any Bannon Institute lecturer who has stood in this spot. As the executive director of the Ignatian Center, I cannot even begin to say how proud I am of the extraordinary vision, work, professionalism, and care with which the whole team goes about its many labors. Here, though, it's fitting for me to single out Teresa Ladrigan-Welpley, who has been really the real genius behind these Bannon Institutes. And I mean genius in the ancient sense of guardian spirit associated with an institution or a place. Let me also thank members of the Ignatian Center ops team under the amazing leadership of Michael Nuttall, to Susan Chun, to Nicole Kelly, an army of student workers, and finally, Margaret Glom. As some of you may know, Margaret is retiring at the end of the year to become a professional grandmother. So as a small token of thanks for everything she has done, and specifically for her encouragement, her commitment to our mission, both as a center as well as the university, her loyal care for me during my tenure, and for really teaching me what good faith is, I would like to dedicate to this to her, this first Lewis I. Bannon SJ Memorial Lecture. So for Margaret. To begin, let me make a confession. The question that forms the title of this lecture is a real one for me. I've been asking it at least since I was 8 years old. How can a thinking person still believe in God? It is an important academic question that grounds a good deal of my own research, but for me it's also a deeply personal question that often entails a certain amount of pain. With my life, with my commitments, with my vows as a Jesuit, I always hope to offer a positive, confident response to the question. As you can imagine, I have a lot invested in it. At the same time, it is not a question on which I can promise or claim easy certainty. In the year 2008, it is an especially hard question. But I think in any age, it's a hard question. At least for me and for many people I trust, faith is a deeply fragile reality. It deals with mystery so deep that it is difficult to talk about it in bright lines. In that respect, its fragility, faith is very much like life. We move forward, sometimes in hope, sometimes in fear or hurt or anger, increasingly aware of our vulnerabilities, our doubts, our personal failures, and of course our mortality. There are joys too, very real joys. But in some mysterious sense, those joys are very frequently linked to what makes us fragile. But more on that in a moment. So there ends my introductory confession. The question that forms the title of this lecture is a real and personal one. I approach it very much as a seeker and as someone who desires to seek not alone, but with others. One further clarification. The lecture is on how can a thinking person still believe in God, rather than why should a thinking person believe in God. It's not my intention here to convince the skeptic or refute the unbeliever. To my mind, that would be a futile and presumptuous, if not outright toxic, exercise. Faith must be always a free response to an invitation that is deeply felt and received. Attempts to convince a person to believe in God or to argue a person into belief frequently disrespect that person's freedom so gravely that it becomes more difficult rather than less difficult for them to entertain the possibility of faith. Rather, what I propose to do in this lecture is to identify some necessary conditions for a thinking person to believe in God. We speak a good deal these days of the importance of sustainability, the capacity to endure. A healthy ecosystem has certain requirements for its long-term well-being. If these conditions are not satisfied, the ecosystem will die from 1,000 different causes. And so it is with faith. Like the environment and like life itself, faith is quite fragile and requires certain sustenance if it is going to thrive. So today, let me simply offer three practical suggestions for its sustainability. First, imagine bigger. Second, befriend intelligent believers. And third, take a risk. Again, my point is not to suggest that if you do these three things, you'll have faith. It's to say that without these three, I'm just not sure how a thinking person could still believe in God. With these conditions satisfied, however, believing in God is an extremely human enterprise, risky but wonderful. So part one, imagine bigger. Last October, we were privileged to be treated to a lecture by the poet Christian Wyman, who recently published the book My Bright Abyss, Meditations of a Modern Believer. The book is an extremely thoughtful set of reflections on religious belief, and it sold more copies than Wyman ever thought would be possible. So when he was here last October, I asked him why he thought so many people are reading his book. And here is what he said from this very place. He said, there is an enormous number of people in this country who find the language of Christianity or the language of religion in general inadequate. And yet their religious feelings, their urge toward God is not dead at all. And that's a terrible spot to be in. It's a terrible bind to be in, to be desperate to experience God, but not trusting any of the words you have, any of the language you have. In other words, people want to talk about core longings, but don't know how, nor are they certain where to look or whom they can trust. I got to say, after 30 years as a Jesuit, I think Wyman's essentially right. In all those years, I have seldom felt an absence of spiritual hunger among individuals or groups. Quite the contrary. The words of the ancient psalmist written over 2 millennia ago still hold true. As a deer longs for running streams, so my soul longs for you. Now, who that you is, who or what the object of our longing is, may be very unclear. Whether or not we are likely to name it God remains an open question, but the longing is often painfully clear. And the fact that we don't have adequate language to talk about our deepest longings, that many people don't trust religious words or forms we have, is, as Wyman says, a terrible bind to be in. Well, we're all aware of the books of the new atheists, who seem bent on saying how malevolent religion is and how stupid believers are. There's also a number of books, some popular but less well-known, that speak about Wyman's terrible bind. In 2010, the syndicated talk show host, Michael Krasny, published a book entitled Spiritual Envy. When I write of spiritual envy, he says, I mean envy of the consolation of faith. Krasny grew up a pious Jew, but came to question the doctrinal claims of his faith. Still, he cannot completely discount them. His difficulty in fully giving up faith is not something that is all that uncommon. He self-identifies as an agnostic, but as I read him, I feel I have more in common with him than not. That doesn't exactly make me an agnostic, but it does suggest that there may be ways of being a believer, even of the committed Catholic variety, that have softer margins than we usually imagine. The distinguished philosopher, legal philosopher, Ronald Dworkin, argued just this point in his book, Religion Without God, published after his death. He asserts that the divide between religious people and non-religious people is simply far too crude. In fact, Dworkin, though not a believer, self-identifies as religious. He writes, quote, "Many people, many millions of people who count themselves as atheists have convictions and experiences similar to and just as profound as those that believers count as religious. They just don't need to speak in terms of a divine entity. Still, they find the universe as awe-inspiring and regard human life as full of purpose." Dworkin suggests that what binds religious people together, whether they believe in God or not, is their rejection of the view that nothing is real except what can be studied by the natural sciences, including psychology. The real division, therefore, is not between theism and atheism, but between religion and naturalism. According to Dworkin, a religious view holds that some transcendental and objective value permeates the universe, that there is some real, ultimate, good independent of us. The naturalistic view, by contrast, he says, asserts that nothing exists besides mind and matter. Well, when we listen sensitively to thinkers such as these, we realize how much common ground there is between people who believe in God and people who don't. Even the Pope has been remarkably validating of the goodness of atheists, and in his Christmas address, invited them to join believers in their desire for peace, a desire, he says, that widens the heart. But if there can be deep common ground between the atheist and the believer, we need to ask, why is God such a fault line? Why is language about God so problematic, even so polarizing? Well, let me suggest one major problem is that we use the word carelessly. It can be used so many different ways that it's not always clear that the word is meaningful. A major mistake that underlies so much public debate is the false presumption that people are using the word God the same way. For example, several years ago, before I ever came to Santa Clara, I happened to overhear the conversation of two friends on the way out of a church in Latin America. I was part of a delegation, and we attended Sunday Mass in a poor pueblo. And it was a wonderful community, clearly built around a lot of love and joy, in spite of the many challenges that people faced. But as we were leaving the church, I overheard two colleagues behind me, and one asked the other whether he didn't find moving this community at prayer. The other replied that indeed he found it very moving. He just didn't buy the idea of some invisible guy up there in the sky that we have to worship and who will make everything okay if only we pray hard enough. Well, now that really jarred me. I thought to myself, is that really what faith is? Is that really what it means for me to have faith in God? What's more, does my colleague really think that that's what I believe? People frequently, what people imagine God, belief in God to be, is really sometimes a rather pathetic caricature. Terry Eagleton, who also was in the Bannon series this year, says that many people in contemporary society, believers and unbelievers alike, hold what he calls the Yeti belief in God. You all know what Yeti is? A Yeti is? The kind of the abominable snowman right there. Somebody who kind of like haunts the Himalayas outside of Tibet. So this is in a lecture that he gave at Yale a couple years ago. Let me quote the description he gives of this view of God. It's very Terry Eagleton. "I mean by this the view that God is the sort of entity for which, like the Yeti, the Loch Ness Monster, or the lost city of Atlantis, the evidence we have so far is radically ambiguous, not to say downright dubious. And because we cannot thus demonstrate God's existence in the reasonably straightforward way we can demonstrate the existence of necrophilia or Michael Jackson, we have to put up with something less than certainty known as faith. In other words, on this Yeti view, faith in God is the belief in the existence of some concrete entity. We cannot really demonstrate the way we can demonstrate other entities. It can be hard, even hard for religious believers, not to think this way, but it's really problematic. So let me return to this conversation in Latin America. Imagine that if on walking outside of the church, we looked up into the sky, and there, lo and behold, saw the old man with his amazing white beard. He miraculously appears in a cloud and in a terrifying voice scolds us. "I am, in fact, up here, stupid." Well, if we take my colleague at his word, a manifestation such as this would presumably count as evidence for God. Presumably, my colleague would have gone back into church, gotten on his knees, started praying harder than ever. But for me, I think it would actually destroy my faith. Why? Because at least for a thinking person, neither is God nor faith anything like the picture my colleague has of it. We need to imagine bigger. Now, Wyman says that people who have spiritual hungers have found language of religion inadequate. And of course he's right. What he didn't say, however, and what does need to be said here, is that the problem is not a new one. While every generation faces its own issues, and while our own age clearly has many unique challenges surrounding religious belief, when it comes to speaking of God, no words have ever been trustworthy. Traditional theology, for instance, has long maintained that whatever we say about God must also be unsaid. God is like a father or mother, but also quite certainly not like a father or mother. So at the beginning of his confession, St. Augustine has a passage in which he asks, "What are you, my God?" And the question leads to a long and highly rhetorical speech that exploits many contradictions. I have it down there for you. "You are," says Augustine, "most hidden yet intimately present, infinitely beautiful and infinitely strong, steadfast yet elusive," etc. The passage is a tour de force that shows Augustine's own mastery of knowledge. But then he gets to the end and asks rather simply, "After saying all that, what have we actually said? What does anyone who speaks of you really say, God? What does anyone who speaks of you really say?" Now, there have been times in my own journey when I have worried that religious expression is in some ultimate sense empty. Those can be dark and uncomfortable moments for anyone, let alone for a priest with the duties of preaching. In those dark and uncomfortable moments, the line between belief and unbelief can seem very blurry. But they also become moments of tremendous freedom, when the question comes in the most direct terms. "Okay, then, where are you, Mick? What is it that you stand for?" And actually, these are not so much moments of intellectual recognition as they are moments of decision, choice. But to choose in the direction of faith requires an exercise of constantly expanding and deepening the imagination. What I had thought and said about God requires revision. The categories have been too small. I need to imagine bigger. And that is really what the journey of faith is: free movement toward a living mystery that is greater than we had ever imagined. The Latins called it Deus semper maior, God always greater. To the question, how can a thinking person still believe in God, any sufficient response will have to say that the meaning of that three-letter word, God, whatever it means, must grow as the thinking person grows. Otherwise, God is really not a living reality at all, and the thinking person's faith is a matter of inert habit rather than an act of true freedom. Our religious language, our religious traditions, our religious practices need not be abandoned, but we need to deepen our understanding of them, and that requires constant reconsideration. Reconsideration, however, is what thinking people have been doing all along. When I first started at Santa Clara, my very first year, in the very first class I taught, I had a remarkable young man in first class I ever taught. He was gay. And in the process of discovering what that meant in the context of the faith in which he had grown up, and which he really loved, somewhere towards the end of the quarter, it was probably the final paper, he wrote a paper in which he described the Thomas Guide to Los Angeles, that his family kept in the glove compartment of the car with a pencil. And his mother said to him, "James, this is a good guide to most things in Southern California. It will almost always get you where you need to go. And I wouldn't be a good mother if I let you out without this map. But there's some things that aren't in here. New roads will be built. Some roads will change. And by necessity, you yourself will find new passages that aren't in this book. Use the pencil to mark your discoveries." Now, for James, this was an excellent image of what faith is. You use reliable guides for established roads, but ultimately the map is only good in its use. You use it, and yet to get where you need to go, in some ways you need to surpass it. I would like to propose that for a thinking person still to believe in God, one must negotiate the mapped and the unmapped, the said and the unsaid. One must certainly not use God as a kind of quasi-scientific explanation of things, but imagine more expansively. For myself, when I say I believe in God, I am making a much bigger claim than saying positing God's existence, whatever that means. Rather, I'm saying something like this. I put my trust in a reality that cannot be grasped or contained or controlled. I put my trust in a reality distinct from any entity or whole set of entities we know as the world, but that somehow interacts with the world the way that being itself interacts with the world, that somehow is exceedingly close to the world in ways that I choose to describe as ultimately good or benevolent or loving, and in ways that are real and in ways that are important. My relationship to this reality orients me toward the world with hope. But we need to imagine bigger. Second, befriend intelligent believers. I've often wondered what direction my life would have taken if I had not gone to a Jesuit high school when I was in my teens. I don't mean to be engaging in special advertising for my religious community, but I was a kid with a lot of questions. It really isn't clear to me where I would have been on matters of faith if I didn't have access, let alone being a priest, right? If I didn't have access to people of intelligent faith around me, people who thought deeply about things and were not afraid to ask difficult questions, people who were willing to engage me with the right portions of kindness and challenge, humor and wisdom. I came to learn not only that my questions would be honored, but they could be shared. And in fact, in sharing it, it was less lonely. I came to learn that being a believer does not stifle critical thought, nor that faith and reason, science and religion are ever enemies. I came also to be exposed to an intellectual tradition that does not close questions, but offers a framework to think about them. And although we do not always arrive at perfect answers, as a matter of fact, very frequently, most of the time we don't, we know that we can pose the significant questions with confidence. Now, most people, most religious traditions stress the importance of a living community as the very fabric or framework within which teachings and practices can be understood. So how can a thinking person still believe in God? Befriending intelligent believers will not turn you into a believer. But it's hard to imagine how belief would be possible alone, without fellow pilgrims. What belief actually means only comes to be known when it is shared with fellow pilgrims. Along the way, they share their wonders, their hopes, their fears, and even allow for each other a space of spiritual vulnerability, in a space in which we slowly, very slowly, ask our questions. Questions like, why are we here in the first place? Or at least for Christians, who is Jesus? So why are we here? In the biography by Walter Isaacson, Steve Jobs recounts the story of a classmate in school taunting him when she found out that he was adopted. His real parents, she said, didn't want him. Jobs said that it was like lightning bolts that went off on his head. So he ran to his parents, who sat him down and said, "No, Steve, you don't understand. We specifically picked you out." And the belief that he was wanted, that he was loved, made all the difference. Now, it strikes me that much of the purpose or even meaning of the Bible, the whole meaning of the Bible, may be to reassure us the way his adopted parents reassured the young Jobs. Only in more recent history have people taken an interest in Genesis as a quasi-scientific account of the way the world came to be. Intelligent believers throughout history have rather taken it as an attempt to ask a very different kind of question. Why are we here? And intelligent believers have understood the drama of Genesis and the Bible more generally to respond, because you are wanted. Intended. Your life is freely given rather than an accident or the result of some necessity or some freak accident. You didn't have to be here, but you are. Enjoy it. And solely by virtue of the fact that you are here and wanted, you are good and irreplaceable and have certain inalienable rights. Now, certainly the answer to this question, why are we here, can be a difficult thing to believe. It can seem too good to be true. Intelligent believers may struggle with it. I struggle with it. There are worthy alternative stories that may emphasize the randomness of why are we here. So friends, choose which story to put your faith in. Decide which story gives you life. And should you put your faith in this story, it would be a mistake to read the Bible, particularly Genesis, for what it is not a scientific or even quasi-scientific account. If it were, it would be a particularly bad one. Did you ever notice, for instance, the discrepancies between among the 7 days of creation? On the first day, God separated light from darkness, called the one day and the other night, and let evening and morning come. That's day one. But it's not until day four that God puts lights in the sky to separate day from night. So 4 days and nights have gone by without any sun or moon. What's with that? Now, an ancient writer born in the 3rd century wrote about the discrepancies. I have it there in the handout for you. I'm going to read it. What person of intelligence will believe that the first and third, second and the third day and the evening and the morning existed without the sun and the moon and the stars? And who is so silly as to believe that God, after the manner of a farmer, planted a paradise eastward in Eden and set in it visible and palpable tree of life, of such a sort that anyone who tasted its fruit with his bodily teeth would gain life, and again that one could partake of good and evil by masticating the fruit tree from the tree of that name. And when God is said to walk in the paradise in the cool of the day, and Adam to hide himself behind a tree? What more need I say, when those who are not altogether blind can collect thousands of such instances, recorded as actual events, but which did not happen literally? Now it's important that you know that the writer of this passage was not an enemy of Christianity. He was Origen of Alexandria, the first great scripture scholar of the Christian tradition, who read these details of Genesis as figurative expressions for use in discerning what he called mysteries rather than actual events. And so it is with ancient thinkers. Augustine, for instance, asserts that the point of the first chapters of Genesis is to help us imagine God creating the world not through some mechanical causes, but with direct intention and care and love. And that is a common theme among ancient thinkers, and indeed the whole community of thinkers down to today, or at least most of them, Jewish and Christian, that we are here with a certain sense of purpose, that we are brought into existence deliberately, and that by virtue of God's intentional approach to creation, the world is exceedingly good, and human beings have the added dignity of being made in God's image and likeness. Now, what it means for the world to be exceedingly good, or what it means that humans are made in God's image and likeness, of course, are questions that we must continue to wrestle with generation after generation. We must discover it again and again in the face of new practical questions and in new circumstances. But that is the task of a community of intelligent believers. Always to go back again to their sources, again and again, in order to pose big questions together. So who is Jesus? For those coming from the Christian tradition, this question has enormous consequences. In many respects, the 20-some centuries of Christian history revolve around the question. For most Christians, its impact on the question of who am I, or who shall I become, or who do I want to be, is crucial. For communities that identify as Christian, their priorities, their qualities of their relationship, and their stance toward the world will be largely affected by who they understand Jesus to be. A community of intelligent believers will never come to final resolution on who this Jesus is. But the way they understand him and the way they ask each other questions about him will affect greatly who they as a community are. Now, I say that, but this is a lecture on how can a thinking person believe in God. And I'm not sure that most people understand the significance of Jesus on that question. I have many friends who have shared with me that they love this figure of Jesus, love his teachings, love his ability to cross religious and cultural boundaries. After all, who cannot love somebody who tells us the parable of the Good Samaritan or the prodigal son, or suggests that what you do for the least of your brothers or sisters, you do to me? But to say that Jesus is the Son of God, or somehow that he's God, this is a hard thing to believe. And when my friends ask me, why do we have to believe that Jesus is the incarnation of the Word of God, I confess I have a lot of sympathy, because I wonder the same myself. Isn't it much easier to believe that he is a great spiritual teacher, an extraordinary moral exemplar whom we are called to imitate? Isn't that enough? And maybe it is. But let me suggest what might be lost if we left it at that. If you approach the question of the divinity of Jesus with the presupposition that the meaning of God, whether or not you believe in God, is clear and known, then I agree. The claim might just be preposterous. But if you approach it from a position of uncertainty or openness about what God actually means, then claims about the divinity of Christ can have radically disruptive even dangerous consequences. Because what do we know about Jesus? He didn't just teach and tell us these wonderful stories. Ultimately, he dies in a horrific fashion as a victim of complicated religious political dynamics of the first century. And while Christians assert that he rose from the dead, if you take seriously that Jesus really did die and was even a rather terrible failure and suffered terribly himself interiorly for everything that we might like about him, and if you claim, as Jesus, Christians have long done, that Jesus is the Son of God, then doesn't God mean something quite different than we normally think it to mean? And all those things we usually attribute to God, omnipotence, omniscience, etc., what do they really mean if we take seriously that God somehow is identified in the flesh with someone who suffered a horrific death? Or as St. Augustine said, what does anyone who speaks of you really say, God? After all, for both believers and non-believers, there's a tendency to think about God as an entity that floats above the chaos of pain and particles in which we're mired. And we can think about Jesus as if he was some kind of like shiny, sinless superhero. But if we entertain the possibility that God may have been incarnate in some definitive way in this person, Jesus, then our concept of God can no longer offer us some kind of easy release from reality. It thrusts us much harder into the gritty heart of reality. And that could mean something like this. God is to be found not only in what is easily recognizable as beautiful, the sunrise of Half Dome, the powerful experience of romantic love or one's children, the perception of some blinding truth or promise, God is to be found also in crucified beauty. When in circumstances that seem utterly tragic and even unredeemable, people find themselves exercising a quality of compassion or moral courage or just steadfast presence of which they had previously been unaware, somehow God is especially found there. Not as some extrinsic object that one comes across, but as an event or a quality or even a kind of power that one is participating in. And you find yourself almost suddenly within the very reality of God, so that, as the ancient theologians said with a hush, you become God. And it's not at all what you expected. When I ask myself why I still believe in God and remain a Christian, it's not that arguments convince me or that even the beauty of nature compels me to believe. It's that somehow in those moments when I'm finding myself facing these difficult questions, even with a sense of loneliness or fear of abandonment, I recognize that Jesus was here. And in a small, even puny way, I make the decision to stay there. Nor can I imagine that I would be able to stay there if it were not for other courageous believers who do likewise. Oscar Romero, the Jesuits who were killed in El Salvador, a whole cloud of witnesses. And at the macro level, the commitment to social justice of, say, the Society of Jesus or Santa Clara is finally not a decision that's based on some secular principle, noble as it is. Rather, it is rooted in an apprehension that this is who God is, someone who once died on a cross and who is still to be found there, who invites me to real commitment with all my doubts and fears. And it's only in company with intelligent believers that I'm even able to think these things or continue to believe in them. It's in company with intelligent believers seeking understanding that I come to know a God who is so, so different from the one I expected and the one atheists frequently deny. finally, take a risk. I used to think that believing in God would give a sense of security, give me a sense of security. I no longer think that. I used to think that God was a kind of divine safety net. I no longer think that. In fact, I believe the opposite. Faith invites us to take a risk. Faith has invited risk, at least since Abraham and Sarah were invited to a covenant with God to leave their homeland in their old age for a land they did not know. Taken a risk since the time Moses encountered the burning bush and was told, go back into Egypt, go see the Pharaoh. There's risk for anyone who takes seriously what Jesus says about loving your enemies, or about taking up your crosses, or about the Son of Man returning to judge us on the basis of what we have done for the least of his brothers and sisters. Those kinds of risks. Still, there are other sorts of risks associated with faith. I've alluded to them throughout the lecture. The lack of scientifically verifiable empirical evidence. The difficulty of knowing what we're really saying when we speak about God. And frankly, the difficulties that organized religion poses for many people. All these raise their own unique challenges to faith. But I would like to end this lecture by pointing to a different kind of risk entirely, which I might characterize as social or even political risk. We live in a time in which there is considerable disagreement, doubt, and anxiety regarding the place of faith in the public sphere. In a recent article in the Jesuit-run America magazine, a fairly conservative commentator argued that there is a trend in American society to marginalize religious influence, or at least contain it within houses of worship. From a very different ideological position, Barack Obama has argued something similar. Before he was elected president, Obama gave a very gutsy, if controversial, speech on religion and politics, in which he challenged the claim of conservatives who argue that liberals have abandoned religion. At the same time, Obama concedes that members of his own party have, for the most part, as he says, taken the bait. Let me quote then-Senator Obama. This is a quote on your handout. At best, we may try to avoid the conversation about religious values altogether, fearful of offending anyone. At worst, there are some liberals who dismiss religion in the public square as inherently irrational or intolerant, insisting on a caricature of religious Americans that paints them as fanatical or thinking that the very word Christian describes one's political opponents, not people of faith. To speak of God outside the walls of a church requires great prudence, care, and yes, risk. What that may mean for a university such as Santa Clara in 2014 is a particularly important question. Like many American universities, as Teresa said, founded in the 19th century, Santa Clara was established to advance the ideals of liberal education within a distinct religious framework. Since then, academic culture has become increasingly secular, and for the most part, that has brought significant gains. At its best, it allows us a common space to speak and interact using non-sectarian language and to accomplish many things for the common good. But secular discourse can also have a flattening effect. If in fact it censors groups and individuals from speaking their deepest convictions in the manner most appropriate to them. The public philosopher Martha Nussbaum speaks of a new religious intolerance in the West for forms of religious expression that are too public or distinct. Muslim women cannot wear the hijab in French schools, and the cause, she avers, is fear of what is different and what is distinct. While this particular kind of prohibition does not exist in the United States, there is often an expectation that serious public discussion remain within what one legal scholar has recently called an iron cage. in which life is lived and discourse is conducted according to the stern constraints of secular rationalism. In this paradigm, God has no place in a university. I do hope that a university such as Santa Clara would continue to be a place that the iron cage may be left unlocked, where one has the freedom to live and act according to his or her deepest convictions, using whatever forms of expression is our right. But that can only work if members of a community are willing not just to tolerate religious and philosophical difference, but to learn patiently what those differences are, to cultivate a more textured ability to understand and talk about these differences and disagree with a commitment to mutual understanding. I like to think that Santa Clara University is confident enough of its own religious identity as to be able to cherish difference. We do not do that without particular tension, sometimes grave tension. And when we speak of religious values in their own distinctiveness, we will often run the risk of misunderstanding or offending each other. I began this lecture by stating that faith is a deeply fragile reality. While some may regard faith as rigorous, even militant adherence to a set of doctrines that establish our security in a changing world, my experience is very different. While accepting the importance of doctrine, the way my former student relied on the Thomas Guide to navigate LA, I also know that what is important is the encounter with the real. In that encounter, we realize how small, yet how resilient we are. And if we are sustained by love, we also come to a deeper awareness of our fragility. Faith is fragile because humans are fragile. Believing in God does not take that away, but becomes the context for exploring the mystery of a rather surprising existence. At times that existence is filled with joy, at times with pain, but always it is the source of wonder. Not everyone needs to refer to God in order to wonder. But for those who do, belief can provide a provisional grammar for wondering together at ever deeper levels. For that grammar to remain at all useful, however, one must always be willing to imagine bigger, befriend intelligent believers, and take a risk. Thank you. So I'm happy to take questions if there are some. It might take a second to think through some of the things that I said. And just to say, those of you back, the students in the back, I will privilege student questions. Sir.
As stated here, one of the problems with religion is its language. Well, even today's church, the modern church, uses the term Holy Mary, Mother of God. What does it mean? And why don't we say what it really is?
Tell me what it really is. So the question is, even the modern church uses phrases like Holy Mary, Mother of God. Why do we say that rather than it is? Well, this would take a longer conversation, but I would say that ultimately where we would end up is we would end up by saying the claim Holy Mary, Mother of God is finally a claim about Jesus, and is Jesus really divine, and is the reality of the relationship between his humanity and divinity so real that in fact we can speak about Holy Mary, Mother of God? And so that's a very short form of saying questions about, you know, if you take Mary, that's finally a question about the relationship of God and humanity in the person of Jesus, which you might not accept, but that's what it's coming out of. And so religious language, yes. Is religious language highly symbolic and kind of like overladen with these multiple layers of tradition? Yeah, I actually think that's a great thing, but you do need to understand it. And we do not always understand it very, very well. Sorry. Gus.
Oh, that's new. You mentioned earlier about how you wrestle with the question of Jesus' suffering and dying, but and how you wonder how could this really be the characteristic of an omnipresent God. But isn't that actually sort of necessary to be an omnipresent God, to know what it was like to truly suffer and die and to understand a complete separation from God? Doesn't that actually make him more omnipresent, not less?
Gus, that's a really good point, and I would say that what you have just done appropriately, quite appropriately, is that you have reinterpreted omnipresence or even omniscience or in light of this understanding of who Christ is. So to your point, yes, and well done, right? So I'm not saying that we throw out, we jettison all of the theological terminology that has been used for God. I'm not saying that at all. At all. I'm saying, though, that in this particular case, if you're a Christian, a lot of that language can be, and in my mind probably should be, reinterpreted and shaped through the lens of this quite remarkable reality of God being present in the person of Jesus. Now, that's a Christian speaking. And you do not need to buy that. But I think you're right. I think traditional theological language always has to be reinterpreted in light of the whole. So well done. Is it questions back there?
I'm saying the balancing act of faith and doubt that you talk about, I think, is wonderful. And to me, I agree so deeply that this is really an incredibly fruitful source of spiritual thinking and feeling. I wonder, though, for you, this must be doubly difficult, and I don't mean you as an individual, but because there's that balancing act between faith and doubt, and that implicitly questions to some degree, I'm asking for your comment on this, the authoritarian model of the church, which has often been quite authoritarian. You're presenting us with a very different model, which I'm personally delighted to hear about. Not that I think it's brand new, but I just wonder about how you negotiate these things, because it's got to be tough.
Great question, Tim. I mean, in some senses, you could see that the second section of my lecture, Befriending Intelligent Believers, is you could see that is one model of understanding what the church is, right? It's a community of believers that mutually engage in significant conversation, and so on that model, wrestling with my own doubts, I have to say, being a member of that community of believers is a great consolation to me, because these people, the great cloud of witnesses, I quote Augustine a lot. I find that they are wrestling with very similar things to me, and I think of the spiritual doubts that Oscar Romero had, even days before he was shot, and yet he remained committed. I find being a member of that kind of ecclesial community immensely powerful, immensely sustaining, immensely helpful to me. And if you were to pin me to say, you know, okay, you have this church, do you love the church? My answer would be yes, absolutely. Why? Because I understand that church to be a huge community, and a community not only in one time but across time. And I take, got to tell you, Tim, immense consolation in that. As frankly, I take consolation in my family. If you're asking me, are there parts of that church that cause me doubt, that at any particular time that there is stupidity in it, that there is a misuse of power and authority, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, I would say absolutely. And I would say, in fact, those same people that I just talked about as the cloud of witnesses also talked about that. So we're not in any kind of, kind of like terrible age ecclesially. I kind of think that this is a function of human fragility mediated through community. And if I look at my family, who I hope none of them are watching on the website, they're crazy, a lot of them, right? And so we can, so I have ceased, Tim, to look for kind of like, let me just talk about the Jesuit community who lives here. Really good men, but we're mixed too. I have learned, perhaps you say kind of like as you have in marriage, I have learned to negotiate the painful reality of being a member of a human community. That doesn't answer all of the questions, and it does not mean that things can't maybe be more right. They should. I do not mean that as an evasive reaction. I really don't, and I hope you don't take me as an evasive reaction. And I have to say, I have been encouraged in the last year. But let's not forget that at the heart of the matter, what the church is that it is a human community. It has particular governance structures that sometimes they are deployed well, sometimes they are not, and very probably they need to evolve. My strong guess is that the man who is the Bishop of Rome thinks the same thing, but I don't speak on his behalf. Question over here. Is it a student?
Hi. Yeah.
Great.
This is going to be a really broad and not very well formulated question, but as far as the question of who is Jesus, and I know that's not really what your talk is about, but I feel like there's a lot of the same risks that come into believing that Jesus is the Son of God, and when you come down to the evidence and the fact that you need to take that risk in order to make the final call. And I feel like what you said with God, there is that inner longing for knowing that there's something more here. I was just wondering, how do you reconcile that same kind of risk in Jesus as the Son of God?
Yeah, that's a great question. Can I just ask just a follow-up question? You're saying that there remain open questions of who this Jesus is, right? Even in a historical context. Mm-hmm. Is that what you're saying?
Yes. So, yeah, just in that openness, just as there's so much openness with the question of God, and you come down to a risk, and I'm just curious how you reconcile that.
Great point. Well, first of all, that's a very insightful comment, and I probably will not do justice in my response. If what you're referring to is there's so little that we actually know about Jesus historically, kind of like from an academic fashion, I think that's right. I think at times it does astound me that we are placing our belief in someone about whom we know really very, very little, right? And you know, is there historical veracities behind miracles and things like that? I think that's one of the things that you know, I hope you get to study that, because that's a really important thing. But few things that I do know, I think that is probably beyond really a reasonable doubt, is that he did die. A pretty horrific death on a cross, and was a failure in a lot of respects. And yet he was a man of God, whatever that means. And I take, to me, following him is a risk, not just because of all of the kind of like the more epistemological questions, but to follow somebody like that is a deep, deep risk. But I would say, too, that I guess as I take this, I do not see Jesus as simply a unique individual character at one moment in history. But if we actually really understand what he was. He was at the center of a movement and a community. And to the extent that that community, to the extent that that community becomes the context for living out the kind of life that he, that we seem to think that he was telling us to, boy, I just find a lot of power in that. And I find encouragement in that, and I find consolation in that, and reason actually to take the risk, finally. So I guess I would not underestimate the importance of the, you know, what I'm calling the ecclesial, or kind of like the larger community, that part of the equation, that we do not do this alone. And I have to say that there are enough people, I mean, I've just bad-mouthed all of the Jesuits that I live with. But both with them, as well as, man, so many people that I have encountered throughout my life, I have felt that the spirit of this man Jesus is really alive, and does call me and compel me in a way that overcomes the either personal risks of following someone who is a failure, or the more academic risks of not knowing a whole lot about him. I actually think that was actually a better question than I thought I was going to. I wish I could be more clear about it. But
hi. First of all, thank you very much. I thought the talk was really, really interesting. So the question I had was, you mentioned earlier in the talk, you talked about the difference between like religious and non-religious.
Yeah.
And you define that sort of as dealing with a religious worldview versus a sort of naturalistic worldview.
Yeah. Yeah.
But you didn't really get into how you make the decision or make the choice to believe in the religious worldview versus the naturalistic one, if that makes sense. Like how you choose to accept one worldview or the other, why you decide to believe one's more valid, if that makes sense.
Yeah. First of all, that's not me who makes the distinction, but I think it's probably a pretty good distinction. It's a philosopher, legal philosopher by the name of Dworkin, right, who makes that distinction. I guess I find it helpful. I don't know how anybody, him or herself, makes that decision. That's up to you. I guess for myself, I'll just speak only personally. The world in which I live imaginatively, I'm sorry, when I can imagine a world that is the religious world, with that worldview, somehow it gives me greater life than if I were to live according to a naturalistic one. I was also thinking, one of the things I do way too much of in evenings when I'm tired and I come home and after dinner, is as a lot of the Jesuits do, I help people who are planning to get married. And it's really kind of like amazing because they're so much in love. And they're really, really, really in love a lot of times. It's not to say that there are intentions too, but they're really, really in love. And they say things that I have to say really move me about their desire to give their whole lives to each other for eternity, sometimes they say, right? And if I were observing other primates as a scientist, I would say, okay, well, this is kind of like a natural biological mating process, right? And I would not give myself to that kind of language and framework of it. And so I guess I do have. I mean, even non-religiously, like I could say no, but you're really not. You're not. This is hormones and you know where you are in life, etc. But I guess I opt for the language of love, which is a much more poetic, textured, beautiful way of talking about the world and interacting than one that would only see them as, you know, kind of like advanced primates. So I guess it's really kind of a choice. What's your name? Jonathan, it's just basically a choice. And I guess I would also say, too, though, Jonathan, is that I think more people, I could be wrong, I think more people opt for talking about the world in symbolic, evocative, kind of like poetic ways, that it seems natural to us somehow. But it's basically a choice. I don't have anything more than that. Sorry. Back here.
So I kind of just had a question. Like, so to me, it kind of seemed like if I were a thinking person, and I was like really, really trying to believe in God, then I would like want to follow, like, I guess you can call these like steps. So my question is kind of like, do you think then, is it like natural for a thinking person to believe in God, or is it kind of like something that you have to, not like force upon yourself, but you have to like take certain like steps or like change your perspective on life to believe it? Or is it just like a natural thing? Like,
oh, that is such a good question. So is believing in God natural, or do you have to take steps in, or kind of like indoctrination or whatever? Is that kind of? I don't know. I guess I wouldn't frame it necessarily as an either or. I think that whether is it natural or not, I don't know. I do think that having some sense of awe in the world is natural. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean you need to believe in God to do that, right? I totally understand that. To be able to talk about that awe and our deepest feelings in religious language, I think a lot of people do find that useful. Not everybody does, but a lot of people do. I don't know that I would call it natural. I would just say it's fairly useful. And I would say, kind of like, for me, again, it's not steps. I never kind of like learned to do this by a book, although at times it's really helpful to kind of like read books. I mean, for me, reading theology was really helpful because it clarified a lot of open questions that I was, frankly, basically just, I didn't know about. I didn't know how to provide an intellectually justifiable answer to a lot of these things. But again, I don't think so much in terms of taking steps as befriending intelligent believers. I think because there's so many things that we learn just by observing people's dispositions. I mean, if you really think about it, the really important things that you've probably learned in life have been by watching people and by being with them. And I guess I've been lucky. I count myself grateful that I have been lucky to grow up among quite really sensitive, intelligent, good believers. So I would not underestimate the importance of being with people who give you life. And a lot of times, if they have a religious language or religious way of practicing at their disposition, hopefully that will become a life-giving way of believing and being a person of faith, rather than one that is soul-destroying or simply oppressive, as it can be too. We have time for one more question.
Hi, Father McCarthy. I just wanted to say first, thank you for such an interesting and very thought-provoking talk. We all very much appreciate it,
thank you.
Sure. But you talked of a disparity of understanding when different people speak of God or Mary or the language of Scripture itself. How do you propose we reconcile these differences, create better understanding for the most amount of people that we can?
So I guess I'm not totally... How do we, there are... Say that again.
That there are different understandings. When people speak of God, we're not necessarily speaking of the same image of God, yeah, or of Mary. Like, we had that question in the beginning where you clarified that we were actually talking about Jesus in the end. How do you fix that when someone comes in with sort of a misconception, or they just haven't been opened to that perspective
yet? Great question. First, you have to establish conditions of trust, right? I mean, you're not going to listen to anything that I say about God or whatever, unless actually you have a sense of trust that basically, at a basic level, I'm a decent human being, right? Otherwise, why would you listen to me? So first, kind of like live in such a way that is kind, in which you can establish trust. And I guess after that, I say study, talk, dialogue. continue to avail yourself of sources, right? I think that that's the thing that's been the most helpful to me, is to read good theology. Now, that does not solve all of the problems by any means at all, but it gives you kind of like the ability to talk about significant things with increasing sensitivity and understanding. And even where you do disagree with others, as I hope you always will, there is, as I say, kind of like a commitment to mutual understanding, that if you and I disagree on something, I understand why you do that, and you understand why I do that. If we can come to that place, wow, we have just kind of advanced so much. We have advanced so much and much further than the way kind of like more acrimonious religious discussions tend to be. So, but first, establish a context of trust, and then really commit to, it's really a kind of a long-term discipline of understanding, which is hard, right? Because we expect everything to come in a seven-second soundbite. It is hard. We have to be committed to these, that wisdom does not come automatically. And it comes sometimes through a lot of painful back and forth. I think Teresa is giving me the sign that I got to go. Bye.
Mick, thank you so much. I think that you issued us a challenge. I'm struck by what you were sharing in that the second to last question about it's also who you are in it, that it's not just what you shared with us today, but your question of how you witness to us really the journey, the community, the questions, the line, in a way that invites us to kind of take courage and to take risk and to keep seeking company with you and with one another. So thank you so much for what you shared and for the invitation that it affords to all of us. Thank you. Couple announcements. You have the evaluations at your tables. If you could share your feedback on today's lecture, that's really helpful for us as we're planning. And then secondly, a little commercial. Same place, same time next week. So that's Tuesday, April 22nd at 4:00. We invite you to join us for the second installment of this quarter's Bannon Institute. It's the title of that event is called Containment or Engagement, the Shifting Role of Religion in Higher Education. And we'll be joined by Julie Rubin of Harvard Graduate School of Education. She's the author of Making of the Modern University, Intellectual Transformation and the Marginalization of Morality, as well as Jake and Rhonda Jacobson, who are co-authors of the book No Longer Invisible, Religion and University Education. And I think what Mick kind of gestured towards the end of his lecture about kind of what is the state of the university engaging these questions, we hope that this next event will invite us to go deeper on that prompt. And for now, though, let's just end by thanking all of you for coming and your contributions and asking you to help me thank Father McCarthy.